thought I should say something about my strange name. God has a great sense of humor when he called me to be an anthropologist with the name Whiteman. Because all my cross-cultural ministry has been in places where people's skin color is dark, in Central Africa or in Melanesia. And I had an occasion once when I was in the Congo, and I'd been away from my city where I collected my mail for about 3 weeks. So I went to the post office to collect my mail, and I said in French, do you have any mail for Mr. Whiteman? And the postal clerk looked at me strangely. He says, pardon, monsieur? So I repeated again, do you have any mail for Mr. Whiteman? He said, sir, we get mail for white people all the time here. And the other thing that people frequently say, I know you're a white man, but what is your name? So God has a great sense of humor, and I've had to live with that for a long time. But I don't know if we change our names in heaven or not, because the white people will be the least numbered there. As we surround God's throne, people from every language, every culture, every race, they'll all be worshiping God from their own language. And the rainbow color of that day, I can hardly wait. You know, I oftentimes say that scene is going to be an anthropologist's paradise. The problem is there won't be very many there. Do you understand what I'm saying? Anthropology as a discipline has the highest number of agnostics and atheists of all disciplines out there. So when I chose to become an anthropologist, my Free Methodist missionary colleagues were very, very upset with me. Because they said, you'll probably lose your faith. We've never yet met a Christian anthropologist, let alone one in the Wesleyan tradition. Why do you think you can become the first one? And later I discovered they had every reason to be concerned. There are a lot of missionaries who've gone off to study anthropology in universities and have lost their faith. So I thank God that God's called me to this rather unique and strange life of helping people connect the gospel to their culture. Now, yesterday I ran out of time, so I'm going to pick up where I left off yesterday, and we'll see where we can go from there. Yesterday I began the series of lectures on contextualization, and I said we need to become advocates and not adversaries of contextualization. And I argued that contextualization is where the gospel meets culture in the Nazarene churches of Asia and the Pacific, and certainly beyond. And I argued that the incarnation of God becoming Jesus the Jew was our biblical model and mandate for contextualizing the gospel. Now, I've often been known as the prophet of doom and gloom when it comes to missionary lifestyles. Because for me, the incarnation of God becoming the Jew and emptying himself of all the power and the prestige and privilege and position of being God's son in order to connect with us is the same way that we need to go into other cultures and connect with those people. A number of years ago, I was doing training with Southern Baptists, and I was just starting, and a young woman stood up. It was a crowd about this size. Southern Baptists were sending out several hundred missionaries a year, and I had the privilege of training about 4,000 to 5,000 of them. She stood up and she said, about 4 or 5 years ago, my husband and I were in this very room, and we heard you speak, and we did not like you. You were asking us to go to Ghana and live like the Ghanaians instead of living like other Southern Baptist missionaries. But somehow we thought God was talking to us through you, and we decided to go to Ghana and live like the Ghanaians. How did you know it would be so great? Our ministry flourished. The gospel got connected to where these people were. It was great. Our children learned Chui before they practically learned English. It was a great experience. On one of those occasions, my husband oftentimes traveled to other villages, and he'd be gone for a week or so. And on one of those occasions, he's in a village, and one night he takes a glass of water. In 24 hours, he's dead. And then she says, because I listened to you, white man, my husband died. I thought, whoa, this is going to be a long 2 days. It probably was a pregnant pause of just a few seconds. It felt like 10 minutes. And then she continued. I'm standing here in front of you and all these people because I want you to hear what I'm going to say. If we had to do it over again, we would do it exactly the same way. You see, the only thing my husband lost was his life. And for a follower of Jesus, that's not to lose anything. That's to gain everything. And then she says, I'm here with husband number two. And we're getting ready to go back to Africa. About that time, the husband makes a beeline for the door. So incarnation is our model. It's our model for contextualization. It's an important theological doctrine for sure. John Hick, in his 1978 book called The Myth of the God Incarnate, tried to convince us that we could have Christianity without this silly idea of incarnation. But John Hick was dead wrong. If God did not become Jesus, we are wasting our time here, and there's nothing left after we die. So the incarnation, important theological doctrine, but it is the most important model of how we need to minister within our congregations. How many pastors stay way above their congregation and never enter into the life of their own people? They don't become incarnational. So I was telling Lynn and Sherry the other day that all my life has kind of been a one-string guitar. And the one string has been the importance of the incarnation as a model for how to do ministry. And so I spoke on that, although briefly, I guess it was yesterday. Now, I also noted that the gospel is often offensive because it offends us. It offends us because it confronts our own sinfulness. But if we offend potential followers of Jesus by a lack of contextualization and a lack of discipleship, they may never hear the offense of the gospel. They may never hear the offense of the gospel that can bring them transformation and salvation through Jesus. So I want to pick up on, start with 1 Corinthians 9, 19 to 23. Let's be an oral society. Put your Bibles down and your phones away. Most of the world does not read, either chooses not to read or cannot read. And the gospel, we've got to really work harder at communicating the gospel through story. Now, I'm going to be using the Good News Translation. It's my favorite translation. I was on the board of the American Bible Society for 27 years, and one of the translations we put together there, I chaired the translation committee, was the Contemporary English Version. Now, that Bible was written for a particular audience. It was written for children who are 5 years old and can have it read to them, and they can understand everything. Or a 9-year-old child can read it themselves. We made a huge mistake. We tested that Bible with adults, and they loved it. Oh, that's what the Bible means, they said. Well, the audience for this Bible, Good News Bible, is people for whom English is a second language. And that's why it's my favorite. It's just so easy to understand. So I'm going to be reading from 1 Corinthians 9, 19 to 23. And the reason I'm doing that is because Paul puts in place this whole idea of incarnation. And it's a wonderful model for us to begin our talk today. So listen, don't read. Paul says, I'm a free man, nobody's slave, in a world where slavery was alive. But I make myself everybody's slave in order to win as many people as possible. Now watch for this phrase, in order to win. It's all through this passage. So while working with the Jews, I live like a Jew. He can't eat any barbecued pork. Why would he do that? In order to win them. And even though I myself am not subject to the law of Moses, all 631 laws, I live as though I were when working with those who are. That's being incarnational. Why would he do that? In order to win them. Now, in the same way, when working with Gentiles, I live like a Gentile outside the Jewish law. Why would he do that? In order to win them. Now, this does not mean that I don't obey God's law. I'm really under Christ's law. So among the weak in faith, I become weak like one of them. Whoa, 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 whoa. That must be a mistranslation. Is he serious? Among the weak in faith, I become weak like one of them? I thought I'm supposed to be strong and show how much I know about God and the Bible. You mean I'm supposed to admit my own doubts and concerns? I read this about 3 or 4 years ago. I've been reading it all my life, but suddenly that I become weak like them? That's incarnation. So among the weak in faith, I become weak like one of them in order to win them. So I become all things to all people that I may save some of them by whatever means are possible. That's the incarnational model of Jesus given feet through the work of Paul and through the work of you and I as we attempt to become all things to all people. Now I'm going to begin, I actually have already started, haven't I? Now today, Lynn says, I don't have to stop at a certain time, but I think we'll get out of here by noon. I want to repeat a little bit of what I said yesterday, quoting Melba Magai, who is the director of the Institute for Studies in Asian Church and Cultures that's here in Manila. She's a wonderful woman who I don't know if she's an anthropologist, but she certainly is trained in that area. And here's what she says. Through almost 5 centuries of Christian tradition, this country remains unengaged by the gospel where it matters most. After 500 years, the gospel's not engaged in this country, among Filipinos, where it matters most, in what anthropologists call the deep structures of culture. Matters of consciousness, worldview, and values. End quote. The renowned Asian theologian M.M. Thomas, in reflecting on why the Indian church is perceived to be so Western and why Christianity is still considered a foreign religion in much of India. He notes that Christianity was brought to India by Western missionaries in the colonial era as an already potted plant. He says, but if they had brought to us the gospel as a seed and enabled us to plant it deeply within the soil of India, it would have grown and flourished. End quote. You see, good contextualization enables the church to grow organically in depth, but the lack of it stifles growth, and over time it degenerates into just a nominal form of Christianity. And this part of the world is full of that. As 2 Timothy 3:5 describes, they will have the form of godliness. Do our churches have the form of holiness? But reject its real power. They will be Christian in name only. Now, this is a challenging problem we see throughout this region, but not only here. I've seen it everywhere I've gone around the world. Now, let's take a closer look at this issue of how our culture and worldview shape what we understand to be the correct form and practice of Christianity. You see, we all have a very clear idea of what Christianity should look like, what we should believe, and how we should practice it. Vincent Donovan, a missionary for 17 years working among the Maasai in Tanzania, in East Africa, tells of his experience in a groundbreaking book called Christianity Rediscovered, published in 1978, and then reissued for the 25th anniversary. He went to Tanzania to convert the Maasai to Christianity, but he is the one who was deeply converted when he rediscovered Christianity while ministering among the Maasai. The Maasai are a nomadic cattle herding tribe, priding themselves as strong warriors protecting their cattle as they roam the East African plains in search of good grazing land. Donovan writes that he was trying to get them to become Christians by settling down, building churches like the American Catholic Church that he represented. It wasn't working, and finally he gave up. He slowly came to realize that all he needed to do was to present what he called the naked gospel, devoid of all the denominational and American trappings that he'd been trying to introduce for years. The power of the Holy Spirit would do the rest. If he would introduce the naked gospel, the power of the Holy Spirit would lead these people to make Christianity their own in their own Maasai way, and they probably wouldn't have to settle down in villages and build a church building because they're nomads. They're wandering through that area. Now, this wasn't going to be easy for him to do because this was not what he was trained to do, and it certainly was not the normal way American missionaries operated. But eventually, however, the message of the gospel and the way to live as a follower of Jesus finally connected with the Messiah when they began to clothe the naked gospel with their own culture. Now the gospel could penetrate their worldview and brought transforming biblical values and culture and met their deepest needs. They were still Messiah, but now they were Messiah followers of Jesus. They did not have to deny their birth identity as Messiah pastoral warriors protecting their cattle in order to affirm their second birth identity as followers of Jesus. Vincent Donovan, who's now gone to be with the Lord, was just a remarkable man, deeply, deeply spiritual. We invited him to speak at Asbury Seminary on two or three occasions. And on one of those occasions, I had him speak to my anthropology class. And he stands up and says, "My name is Vincent Donovan. I'm a recovering missionary. I'm a recovering missionary." Now, what did he mean by that? You see, his missionary approach had been to take a church and plan it that way to look more Catholic and more American, and he realized, no, I just need to communicate a naked gospel and let the Holy Spirit do the work. Now, let me illustrate what was happening with Vincent Donovan and his ministry among the Maasai. So, we start out with Christian meanings. Now, what would you put in Christian meanings? What are some of the basic things that all Christians can agree on as they take the gospel and the plan of salvation from one country to another? What would you want to see go into this category of Christian meanings? What should we not leave home without? I'm asking you a question. Pardon? My culture? No, I don't want to leave with my culture. I'm talking about Christian meanings. These are things that all Christians should agree with. Good and loud so we can hear you, and then I'll repeat it. The Bible. Absolutely. Scripture is really important, and that's one of the reasons Bible translation is so important. So the Bible needs to go in there, okay? What else?
Jesus.
Jesus is very critical there. What else? Holiness. Holiness, we're going to put that in there. Now, we're going to not quite sure what holiness looks like in different cultures, but we'll put it in there. What else? Is that enough? I can't hear you. Well, since you're not going to mention, I am. I think we better put the Holy Spirit in here, or we're dead in the water, okay? So we start out with these Christian meanings. Now, we wouldn't put a form of baptism in there because we don't agree on baptism. So we're not going to put our favorite form of baptism there. We're just going to say the baptism is an initiation rite that oftentimes people go through when they become followers of Jesus and communicate their commitment to Jesus as they go. Now, the next thing is we want to get these Christian meanings into the mind of our missionary communicator. Now, I've drawn a bit of a caricature here. Given him a pith helmet and a 25-pound Schofield Bible under his arm. Sorry, stomping through the steaming jungles to reach the teeming millions. Do these Christian meanings go directly into the mind of the missionary communicator? Well, what gets in the way? I mean, this is what I want to communicate, just the pure gospel, right? You're shaking your head, no, that doesn't happen. Well, how does it work? What gets in the way? Oh, the missionary's culture. Okay, well, let's take a look at that. Yes, in this case, my North American worldview and my denominational grid. Now, I've got the gospel plus what? Plus my culture, plus my denominational distinctives. Now, how many of these different worldviews are there in the world? There are at least 8,000 because each language has a slightly different worldview. Well, how many different denominations are there? different expressions of what it means to be a follower of Jesus. The first time we counted them was 1980 for the World Christian Encyclopedia. At that time, there were 23,000 different denominations. 20 years later, we counted them in the year 2000 for the next edition, and 23,000 had now risen to 34,000. Last time they were counted, 2010, 45,000 different denominations of Christianity in the world. And each one thinks they are the only one. I grew up as a Free Methodist, and I knew that God had blessed the Free Methodists more than anybody else. You Nazarenes were close. My sister married a Catholic in 1965, and my grandfather, who was a leader in the Free Methodist Church, said to my sister — my father had died when I was 12, said, "I would rather go to your funeral than to go to your wedding married to a Catholic." I was stuck. I had to give my sister away. I was 18 years old. What should I do? Should I stand in the place of my father and give my sister away? Or should I stand for the truth and refuse to have anything to do with that Catholic wedding, which many of our relatives did? I mean, I was in agony what to do. And finally I realized, my father's not here, and I must honor my sister. They've been married for over 50 years. They're not Catholics. They're not Free Methodists. They've become Southern Baptist. Doesn't God have a great sense of humor? Okay, so now we've got this gospel plus, and for me, as a Free Methodist, I'm sure this was not intended, but I got the message as a Free Methodist growing up as a kid in the 1950s that the gospel was five things you did not do. You did not smoke, you did not drink, you did not dance, you did not play cards — we played Rook instead — and you did not go to movies. And as long as I didn't do those five things, I was in. Is that the gospel? That is not the gospel. I remember when I went to my first movie, I think I was 15 years old, and as I walked into the theater, I broke out in a sweat. My hands were clammy like they are now. And my stomach started churning. I said, "Oh, what if Jesus comes back now and finds me watching this movie?" Now, do you know what movie I went to see? The Ten Commandments. But my denomination said I was in the wrong place. Now, all those five things have good reasons. Absolutely. Most of them are health reasons. But it has nothing to do with being a follower of Jesus. And then I discovered that verse in Colossians many, many years later: don't make rules about what you eat and drink. And that's what my denomination had done for a long time. Okay, so now we've got the gospel plus. Now we've got to get it into the Messiah worldview so that it really connects with this person. Once again, it's a caricature. Okay. So how is the gospel? Now remember, we started out with Christian meanings. That's what we want to get all the way through here. So the question is, what's the evidence? How many Christian meanings got through? Nothing was getting through until Vincent Donovan realized that he had to introduce a naked gospel instead of his American Catholic gospel. And when he made that breakthrough, then the Messiah said, "Oh, now we understand how the gospel connects to our worldview." And it was transformed. And they became followers of Jesus in the Messiah way. Now, of course, there really is no pure gospel, because we read the gospel through the lens of our culture and our worldview. And when we communicate it, we communicate it through this. Now, what is this in my hand? It's a baton. And a baton is used in relay races. Now, for many years, the Americans had the fastest runners in the world, until we got struck by a bolt of lightning. Now we don't. They come from Jamaica. But we never won the relay race in the Olympics. We either dropped the baton or we exchanged it outside the exchange zone, which is only 20 meters, and you have to give it away to the next person within that small area. So this is a baton, and I want to see this baton that represents the gospel. We want this gospel to go, as best we can, Christian meanings from the missionary communicator to the non-Western pagan receptor. So this is the pure gospel, the naked gospel. But the naked gospel did not come to us naked. No. The naked gospel came to us in a Jewish culture, a Jewish cloth. In fact, the early debates of the church was, can you be a follower of Jesus without becoming a Jew? In Acts chapter 15, the Jerusalem councils, I call the Jerusalem council the first and most important business meeting. And they decided, no, you can be a follower of Jesus without having to become a Jew. What a huge breakthrough. But we're still influenced by that Jewish culture, aren't we? Our whole Old Testament is. So how do then we take this this gospel, recognizing, of course, that there is some Jewish flavor there? We Americans have taken the gospel all over the world, wrapped in the American flag, without even realizing it. And so when the American gospel in the last 100 years came to this country, it looked very American. And you have all your different denominations in this country. I don't know how many are here. But is it no wonder that this gospel hasn't penetrated the deepest levels of your worldview? So, no. Here's what we must do. I'm an American. I can't help it. So I don't deny it. I just put it behind me. Maybe I put it at the cross. And hopefully, somehow, the gospel can take on a Filipino understanding. So now we're going to send people from Asia Pacific Nazarene Theological Seminary, where you're learning all these things, and we're going to send you as a missionary to India. Do you go with this gospel? Is this the gospel you take? No. You're going to learn through your professors here about missiology. Now, you're still Filipino, but you're going to take the naked gospel and let what happen? Let it become an Indian gospel. Now, of course, you know I'm making huge generalizations because, I mean, there are so many different cultures in India. For example, most of the Christians in India are from the south, from Kerala. And when they go north to Delhi and beyond, they take a Kerala Christianity with them. And they are more paternalistic than British ever were. I know. I've been working with Indian pastors and missionaries for about 10 years now. And it's a struggle for them because that's the only kind of Christianity they know. So let's see that this American Christianity eventually got to Korea. Presbyterian and the Methodist missionary arrived on the same boat in 1884 in Korea. And now Koreans are taking the gospel all over the world. America has the most missionaries that we're sending, about 45,000. Korea has the second most missionaries, about 25,000. But as you Korean missionaries go, what must you do with the gospel? Do you take your Korean culture with you? Now, this is going to be a challenge for you more than most of us, because you come from the most homogeneous society in the world. And the only way you understand to be a follower of Jesus is the Korean way. But when you go to China, you're going to have to put your kimchi away. maybe you don't want to go to China. So let's go to Papua New Guinea instead. Oh, the gospel in Papua New Guinea compared to the gospel in Korea? Entirely different. Entirely different. But you Papua New Guineans now, you're starting to take the gospel other places. You're going to be a Papua New Guinean. You never have to deny your birth identity. But when you go to South Africa, you better take a naked gospel. And let the people there, who are even struggling with post-apartheid South Africa, let it be clothed with the culture of the Xhosas, the Zulus, the coloreds, the Asians, the Afrikaners, and the English speakers. Are you getting the message? Do you see how important this is? Yeah. That's contextualization. Very simple. But unfortunately, we've been very hesitant to do our cross-cultural ministry in that way. Now, the title of our talk yesterday was The Gospel and Culture, Advocates or Adversaries of Contextualization. And I argued that there should not be an adversarial relationship between the gospel and culture, not at all, like between the ground gospel and the sky gospel. No, they should come together. And I talked about culture as not the enemy of the gospel. In fact, rather, cultures of the world are gifts of God's grace. And when we look at it that way, instead of seeing it as the enemy, it makes a whole different way in terms of how we approach it. The gospel demands to be contextualized into every culture, among every people group, at every period of human history. When this is not done, then people will become only nominal cultural Christians, and the world is full of them. It must break God's heart. If we avoid engaging culture with the gospel, we will become Christians in name only, not true disciples of Jesus. Now today I want to continue our discussion on contextualization, but we're going to look in more depth about worldview and how the gospel must connect at that deep level. So we have a slightly different topic for today. Okay. So we're now starting today. Now, this morning, I just gave you an illustration of how we, as cross-cultural witnesses, may start out desiring to communicate only Christian biblical meanings and values and principles that I call Christian meanings, but we often end up communicating the gospel plus our cultural preferences, plus our denominational distinctives, without even realizing that we're doing it. That's the amazing thing. We're not even aware that we're doing it. It just feels so natural, so right. Now, the end result is that we often offend potential followers of Jesus for the wrong reasons. And Christianity is rejected. Or if it is accepted, it is accommodated only on the surface of a culture without bringing real transformation at the deeper levels of our worldview. So, now you notice we're not talking about a Maasai worldview anymore. We're talking about Asians' worldview. And your paper this morning talked about how much diversity, a religious diversity, cultural diversity, linguistic diversity. This is the most diverse part of the world. Now, the very most diverse part of the world is Papua New Guinea. Of the 8,000 languages in the world, 12,500 are spoken on the island of New Guinea. And that's why anthropologists just love it, because there's so much cultural diversity. In fact, there's a definition of a New Guinea family. It's one man, two wives, 10 children, and an anthropologist. So what we're looking for now is Asian worldview, and then, of course, we want to see the gospel come through that. So I want to discuss what is worldview, how it impacts the way we read the Bible and understand what it means to become a follower of Jesus, and why it is so resistant to change. This is the challenge. It's deep within us, but it's very, very resistant to change. I'll also discuss why there's so much opposition to contextualization. I'm going to look at 6 different reasons. And I'll make some suggestions about how we can overcome this opposition. So let me begin by talking about worldview. What is a worldview? What is a worldview? I see worldview as the very center of who we are, and my 25-cent definition goes something like this. A worldview is the central governing set of concepts, presuppositions, those things we assume, and values which a society lives by and helps them make sense of the world. We all have a worldview. Now, people are normally not consciously aware of their own worldview. Even though these values and these assumptions, they underlie their actions, their behavior, and they give it meaning. Now, here's an example. Sometimes when you're trying to figure out where is the worldview in a particular society, it shows up in certain themes. Now, we have a theme in American culture called cleanliness is next to godliness. Cleanliness is next to godliness. Now, that's deep, deep within us, and we're not even aware of it until we wander into a place that's absolutely filthy. There's rats running around, there's dirty diapers in the street. I mean, it's just garbage. And our whole worldview starts clicking away. Cleanliness is next to godliness. Cleanliness is next to godliness. This is filthy. What is the unconscious conclusion we draw? If cleanliness is next to godliness, this is filth, where is God? Not there. Not there. Now, is that going to affect the way we perceive people? Is that going to affect the way we relate to people? Absolutely, absolutely. But we're not even aware of it. Now, cleanliness is next to godliness is so biblical, it must be found somewhere in the Bible. Maybe in Leviticus somewhere? Do you know where it's found in the Bible? Maybe Hesitations? First or second? It comes from Benjamin Franklin, whose picture's on the $100 bill. In a book he wrote called Poor Richard's Almanac. Here's another one we love as Americans. God helps those who help themselves. God helps those who help themselves. Now that sounds right. You know, pick yourself up by your own bootstraps. That's a phrase we use all the time. Although we don't know what bootstraps are. So we go down to Guatemala. And 2% of the population controls 80% of the land. And there's endemic structural poverty. And we see young men sitting around, there's no work, doesn't look like they're doing anything. And so our worldview starts clicking away. God helps those who help themselves, and you're not trying to help yourself, why should I care? Is that going to influence the way we relate to these people? The way we connect to them, the way we perceive them, the way we talk to them? Absolutely, but we're not even aware of it. God helps those who help themselves. Now, that does sound more biblical, right? Sorry, it's the same author, Benjamin Franklin. So you see, a worldview is even more basic than religion, even though they both serve similar functions. Paul Hebert notes that, and I quote, "A worldview provides people with their basic assumptions about reality." Our worldview tells us what is real and what is not real. Many of us in this room do not think evil spirits are real. We think it's superstition. But others in this room know that evil spirits are very real because you've encountered them. A worldview provides us with the basic assumptions about reality. Religion provides them with the specific content of this reality. Now, if worldview is even more basic than religion, then I have to confess I'm more American than Christian. I'm more American than Christian. And this is why discipleship is so, so important. Well, we learn our worldview unconsciously in the first 5 years of our life. By the time we're 5 years old, our worldview is pretty much in place. And that's because by the time we're 5 years old, we have our first language. And our language accounts for about 75% of our worldview. And it remains very resistant to change for the rest of our lives. There is an objective reality around us. There is a real world out there, but we don't see it the same way. There is an objective reality, but what we understand is real is culturally agreed upon perceptions of reality in our minds. Now, that is a phrase that's very important. What are the culturally agreed upon perceptions of reality? So if you have a culturally agreed upon perception that evil spirits just don't exist, they're just superstition, then you're never going to see them. But if your culture says, oh, they are real, and we have to deal with them, then you will see them. So our worldview then bridges the gap between objective reality and the culturally agreed upon perception of that reality, which we carry in our minds. That's the huge, huge thing right there. Our worldview bridges the gap between the objective reality around us and the culturally agreed upon perception of that reality that is in our mind. Now, worldview also functions as a lens through which we view reality. Now, I'm going to exchange my glasses here for a moment. A worldview is just like this. And after about 10 minutes, I'm not going to know. This is the way the world is. And you can't convince me otherwise. Until maybe I go into another culture and, whoa, I take off my glasses and I see things I never saw before. Many of us are walking around with sunglasses all our life, and we never see cultural differences. We never see them. I can't do this because now I can't read what I'm writing. So I have to get rid of my American worldview for a minute. So we learn our worldview first 5 years of our life. It remains very resistant to change, and our worldview determines how we observe objective reality. Now, we can use an iceberg to demonstrate this. Now, in this picture, you can see that 90% of the iceberg is below the surface. Below the surface. In the same way, most of our culture is not what we can see and taste and smell. No, it's not the observable parts of our culture that are the most important. It's not what tourists see. That's not important at all. Now, I love this new shirt that was given to me yesterday. But this isn't Filipino culture. It is, but not the most important part. What's really important is the worldview of the people who designed and made this shirt. And that is what we cannot see, but we can see the products of their work. Now, rather, it's what we don't see that is far more important. It's what we don't see in another culture that is far more important. Now, if the way we go about our mission work is primarily to try to convince people to change their behavior and to conform to what we believe is appropriate, what appropriate Christian standards, and if we do not disciple people to connect the gospel to the deeper parts of their worldview, then they will become nominal Christians and Jesus will not become Lord over all of their life, but only part of it. So let's take a look at how this would work. Here's the worldview. Here's where we have behavior. And so much of our cross-cultural ministry has been trying to get people to change their behavior. But unless the worldview is what undergoes change, and remember, it's the most resistant part, we'll be Christian in name only. Now, where would you find religion? Where would religion show up on this iceberg? What do you think? It's got to be here. Any idea? Where? In our consciousness, yes, but religion's also in our unconscious. So I see religion is right here. Just above the surface in religious behavior and just below the surface in our creeds, in the things that we can say. Apostles' Creed, I believe in God the Father, maker of heaven and earth, and our Lord Jesus Christ. Those are things I can articulate. But that's still fairly near the surface. So much of our missionary work has been up here. And a little bit has been down here. But that's not where the real change needs to occur. The real change needs to come down into this part. I believe that nominal Christians are a consequence of the lack of discipleship and the lack of contextualization. Now, I've been working on this for years and years. And I've come to the conclusion that the only way the gospel can get to the bottom of our worldview, to transform us there, is through the process of discipleship. I'm going to talk more about that. Discipleship is the missing ingredient in most of our cross-cultural ministry. Now, I believe that nominal Christians are a consequence of the lack of discipleship and the lack of contextualization. We pray for revival. And yes, we pray for revival. But we haven't done our homework to start that, to disciple people at the deepest levels of their worldview. And we haven't communicated the gospel in such a way that engages their deepest part of their worldview. Melba McGuy says, Christianity has been here for 500 years. And it's not connected to the deepest part of where people live. Now, what are those deep worldviews, areas in the culture from which you come, that the gospel is not adequately addressed? Do you know what they are? What are those areas of life and death that you don't talk about in church? You don't talk about in church, because that's not church talk. And yet those are the very things that drive us. A number of years ago, I was doing some training and a seminar on cross-cultural mission in Kenya among the World Gospel Church. And it was supposed to be a seminar for about, maybe 100 pastors, but they decided to open up the whole church, and there were 800 people there. And this was about a month after the post-election violence had occurred in Kenya, where Kikuyus were killing Kalenjins, and Kalenjins were killing Kikuyus, two different tribes. Christians on both sides were killing each other. And as a result of that, when I arrived there on the grounds, I could hear the talk, and I could discover that accusations of sorcery and witchcraft were just going all over the place. And I realized people did not know what to do for it. And so when I stood to speak before 800 people, I said, I've observed that sorcery and witchcraft are really, really struggling. You're really struggling with this. But you never talk about this in church, do you? Oh, no, we would never talk about that in church. My goodness, if the gospel's not going to make a difference at that level, then what good is it? We're just playing church on the surface. If I'm struggling with sorcery and witchcraft down here, in terms of my assumptions and my worldviews, the gospel better make a difference. Could I actually end up killing other Christians because my worldview is committed more to my tribal identity as a Kikuyu? I say, no, I'd never do that. Are we sure? Am I more Christian or am I more American? Now, because so much of our worldview is unconscious, we don't realize its impact in influencing how we understand who God is and even how we understand and read the Bible. We don't need to be frightened of this, but we do need to become aware of it. You see, we don't relativize the Bible when we acknowledge that people with different worldviews living in very different societies and at different periods of human history will read and interpret the Bible differently. Now, this is the way God intended it to be and why Bible translation is so important. Here's an example from Papua New Guinea. Wycliffe Bible translators, they always start with the New Testament. And what's the first book in the New Testament? Matthew. How many of you have ever gotten blessed out of your socks by reading the first 17 verses of Matthew? Just great, riveting devotional material, right? It's all the generations of Jesus. Now, there are four interesting women, by the way, in that genealogy. Well, those 17 verses don't do much for me, but they sure did something for the Bina Mataran in Papua New Guinea. This was a small group of people who had been sort of pushed all over that island. They'd been trampled down by others, and they were sort of looking up to see bottom. Their sense of self-confidence and self-concept was just eroded. Bible translator went to live and work among them. He tested out his translation. First 17 verses of the New Testament. And they asked him, so Jesus must have been real if he had ancestors. That's right, he was a real person. Did Jesus care about his ancestors? What do you think the Bible translator said? He said, yes, they did. Now remember, ancestors are at the bottom of the worldview issue for these Papua New Guineans. And then they asked another question. Does that mean God cares about our ancestors? Whoa, that's a big question. Where in seminary do we have a course on the theology of ancestors? And yet this is one of the biggest issues throughout Asia and in Africa. But we don't even see it. We're oblivious to it, and we never talk about it in church. Those 17 verses, the genealogy of Jesus. Jesus is real. He cared about his ancestors. Then they asked the Bible translator, does God care about our ancestors? How do you think he responded? Sorry, too late. There's a theology that would say that. God cares about your ancestors and loves your ancestors. Then God must care about us. We are created in God's image? Yes. Wow. They had a whole new sense of who they were because of the 17 verses of the New Testament. Those 17 verses were the key that unlocked the door to understanding of who they were in relationship to God. And there was literally a people movement of the Bina Modern into faith in Christ. Hallelujah. Now, this is going to be heretical, so maybe we should shut off the cameras. Is it possible that those 17 verses were just waiting for the day when the Bina Modern would discover them? And those would be the key to open the door for their salvation. I have so much trust in this Bible. And it doesn't bother me when people read it differently than I do. Because the power of the Holy Spirit in Scripture is just unbelievable. I'm looking forward to meeting those Bina Modern someday. Man, anthropologists are going to have fun in heaven. Well, here's another example about how our worldview and cultural values influence how we interpret the story of Joseph in Genesis. You all know the story. Now, if you ask most Americans, North Americans, to explain the meaning of the story of Joseph, they will say, oh, it's the story of a man who always remained faithful to God, even when he was treated cruelly by his brothers and falsely accused of immorality with Potiphar's wife and then thrown into prison. He never gave up. This is good American rugged individualism at play. Is that the story of Joseph? Of course it is. Now, when I ask a group of African Christians to tell me what the story of Joseph is all about, they say, Whiteman, it's so obvious. It's the story of a man who never forgot his family. Is that the story of Joseph? Absolutely. Absolutely. Which interpretation is correct? They both are. And that's the power and authority of Scripture. It could be read through the eyes of people in radically different cultures, and with the power of the Holy Spirit, the Bible can be understood and applied in their lives. But it won't be unless it connects with their culture at the worldview level. In a recent book, by Randolph Richards and Brendan O'Brien, 2012, titled Misreading Scripture Through Western Eyes, Removing Cultural Blinders to Better Understand the Bible. The authors demonstrate how significantly our worldview influences the way we understand the Bible and practice our faith. Moreover, we're not even aware that's happening. We're not aware that we have blinders on. We think we're reading and interpreting the Bible correctly in the same way as the original audience read and heard it. Most of the original audience heard it more than they read it. We believe that despite the significant time lapse from today to 2,000 to 4,000 years ago, and from a radically different cultural perspective, and through the lens of our language that was so different from Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek, we assume we read and interpret the Bible the same way the original readers and hearers of the word understood it. So we launch into simplistic and naive phrases like this: the Bible says what it means, and it means what it says. Oh, really? Richards and O'Brien remind us that, quote, the most powerful cultural values are those that go without being said. They're at the bottom of our worldview. They're at the bottom of our iceberg. So when we use the phrase, it goes without saying, we're unconsciously tapping into the deep worldview assumptions. Because of the cultural distance between the biblical world and our contemporary setting, we often bring modern Western biases to the text without even realizing it. For example, when Paul exhorts women to dress modestly, we automatically think in terms of sexual modesty. But Paul is more likely concerned with economic modesty, that Christian women should not flaunt their wealth through expensive clothes and gold jewelry. And Western individualism, deep, deep within our worldview, leads us to assume that Mary and Joseph traveled alone to Bethlehem to register with the government. What went without saying was that they were likely accompanied by a large entourage of extended family. What are those areas in your life where you frequently think or say, it goes without saying? In my North American society, it often goes without saying that blacks are inferior to whites, that God loves Christians more than Muslims, that women are not as important as men, that Republicans are more Christian than Democrats. That got you. So do we have a more Christian president now? That wealthy people are more important than the poor? It just goes without saying. On the surface of a culture, those things which we can see and touch and smell, that is how we dress, what we eat, how we build our houses, how we grow crops and conduct business, they can change rather quickly and fairly easily. However, at the deep structures of culture, at the worldview level, it can take centuries to change, if ever. It is the surface structures that adapt quickly to influences and change easily over time. Just observe technology, how technology has changed the Philippines, how it has changed your Filipino life. Many of you are reading the Bible on these little things here. But has the gospel changed people at the deeper level of your worldview? Technology changes things quickly, but at the deeper level of our worldview, who we really are, it remains resistant to change. 50 years ago, this year, Father Jaime Bolatao in the Philippines wrote a groundbreaking article titled Split-Level Christianity. Split-level Christianity may be described as the coexistence within the same person of two or more thought and behavior systems which are inconsistent with each other. However, those who practice a form of split-level Christianity see no inconsistency at all. They experience little to no guilt and do not consider themselves hypocrites. They live along two parallel tracks of belief. As long as this incongruence is taken for granted as normal, that is, it goes without saying, it will remain unconscious. Bulatao noted that because Christianity has not engaged the deep spiritual nature of Filipinos, there has arisen a form of Christianity that was not integrated into the life of Filipinos. On the more abstract level, the form of Christianity that was introduced addressed important issues of ultimate concern, like what will happen when we die? Who created the universe? Why are we here? What purpose do we have? Those more abstract philosophical questions were easily answered through the kind of Christianity that was introduced, initially by Spanish Catholics and later by American Protestants. I wonder, however, how often primal people in Asia and the Pacific even ask those philosophical questions. On the everyday level, however, Bulatao noted that Filipinos are concerned with power to overcome evil spirits, or search for explanations why tragedy strikes, like a child is killed, like a woman miscarries her baby, why the gardens don't grow, why typhoons come and do so much damage, how to relate to one's dead ancestors without being afraid of them. You see, the form of westernized Christianity introduced into this country initially by Catholics 450 years ago, and the last 100 years by Protestant missionaries, does not seem to provide answers to these very vital everyday questions. It provides answers up here in the sky theology, but the ground theology seems to be missing. So Filipinos continue to rely on traditional pre-Christian explanations that arise from the deepest part of their worldview. In other words, they practice a form of split-level Christianity. Are Filipinos the only ones who practice this form of split Christianity in the world? Of course not. We find it throughout Asia and the Pacific. It is endemic in Africa. And yes, North Americans also practice a form of split-level Christianity. They may not rely on magic or consult diviners, but for many Americans, Christianity provides them with a faith that tells them what will happen when they die and the big story of God's mission in the world. But when it comes to everyday concerns, they often put more faith in science and medicine than trust in Jesus to make a difference in their everyday lives. Melba Magai, in her edited book, The Gospel and Culture, Contextualization Issues Through Asian Eyes, comments on this form of split-level Christianity. She notes, "The Filipino rarely sees the need to integrate his religious life with everyday ethical behavior. He sees nothing wrong with posting naughty sex stickers alongside the image of the Sacred Heart on jeepney windshields or dashboards. He goes to mass and donates time and money to parish affairs while engaged in smuggling, illegal gambling, or maintaining a number of mistresses. The nation's leaders are known to loot wholesale the nation's coffers and yet seem not incapable of displaying fervent devotion, like walking on one's knees to altars of various churches in an effort to sway the powers, the supernatural powers." Magai goes on to say, "On the surface, it may look like a lack of integration, a split in the Filipino consciousness. However, this may be rather a function of the primary trait of the culture, the power to accommodate influences." The phrase she uses is mula sa labas, without being changed in the loob, or the deep worldview of the Filipino. That place where the seat of our entire being and consciousness resides. And she says, "For the most part, we adapt, but we do not convert. For the most part, we adapt, but we do not convert." Now, what's the difference between adapting and converting? Adapting is simply changing behavior at the top of our iceberg. Converting is a change of allegiance to Jesus as Lord over everything, our time, our money, our relationships. This is why contextualization of the gospel is so important for deep spiritual growth. Without it, people may change their behavior, but not their innermost being. The Wesleyan holiness movement in the last century sometimes fell into this with a lot of legalism about how to dress appropriately, what not to eat or drink, behavior and places to avoid, and a lot more. It's not what the original holiness movement intended to be, but it's what it became. One Christian college, in fact, founded at the end of the 19th century, advertised that their school was 9 miles from the nearest known source of sin, and therefore it was a safe place to send your children to school. 9 miles from the nearest known source of sin. I believe that true conversion to Jesus as Lord occurs at the worldview level. But if the gospel does not connect at that level, then we may appear and act like Christians in public, on the surface, where we see religious behavior. That's why I just love these songs this morning. They captured all that. But we will have not yet taken on the mind of Christ in our innermost being. Now, I think the primary way that the gospel engages our worldview is through the process of very intentional discipleship. Now, listen carefully. This requires contextualization. Discipleship requires contextualization. I want you to put those two things together. But if the gospel is not contextualized to reach the deepest part of our culture and worldview, we are unlikely to experience what Paul wrote in Romans 12, the renewing of our mind. Paul writes in Romans 12:2, "Do not conform yourselves to the standards of this world, but let God transform you inwardly by complete change of your worldview. Then you will be able to know the will of God, what is good and is pleasing to him and is perfect." Hear that again. Do not conform yourselves to the standards of this world, but let God transform you inwardly, not on the surface, changing your behavior, inwardly, by a complete change of your worldview. And until we have that change of worldview, then we'll not, until that happens, we will not be able to know the will of God and what is good and is pleasing to him and is perfect. You see, if we do not have our worldview transformed by the power of the Holy Spirit, then we cannot know the will of God. So how does this happen? How do we make sure the gospel transforms at the deepest level? I believe lifelong intentional discipleship is the key. Lifelong intentional discipleship is the key. And by discipleship, I don't mean filling in the blanks of a discipleship workbook. I'm sorry. That may be a start, but it doesn't take us very far. I mean living one-on-one with those who are not yet followers of Jesus or who are at the beginning of their pilgrimage of becoming more like Christ. It means trusting the Holy Spirit to enable them to discover what the Bible says and how it applies to their different areas of need, not telling them what we think it says and from our cultural and denominational perspective, and then giving them answers to questions they may not even be answering. Giving answers to questions they may not even be asking. Now, in my travels around the world in recent years, when I've been conducting workshops and seminars on crossing cultural barriers with the gospel and planting truly indigenous churches, I've stressed the importance of pastors and missionaries being intentional about discipleship. I believe the discipleship process should begin even before people come to faith in Jesus. I want you to hear that. Oftentimes we think, well, discipleship begins after they become followers of Jesus, after they get their ticket out of hell. No, I think it becomes even before. And the reason I say this is because God's prevenient grace is already at work in their lives. So often when I would ask church workers if they are discipling others, and not just preaching sermons, they would confess they are not. Sometimes their excuse is that they're just too busy running their churches. They don't have time. But when I press them, this is what I have heard all over the world. They often confess they don't know how to disciple others because they themselves have never been discipled. No one ever discipled them. How many of you as pastors, how many of you as youth workers have never been discipled? I would guess that many of us in this room have never been discipled. If our theology emphasizes getting people saved to avoid going to hell more than growing in Christ-likeness, it's no wonder that very little discipleship happens. So we end up with churches full of nominal Christians. I believe that every follower of Jesus throughout their entire life, needs to be discipling another person. And get this, and we need to have another follower of Jesus discipling us. Throughout our life, we should be discipling someone else, and someone else should be discipling us. It's a continuous process in our walk with the Lord. Who are you intentionally discipling? And who is discipling you? If you don't know, then God have mercy on you and on me. Effective discipleship requires contextualization, but we are too often afraid that this will lead to syncretism if we don't control the process and the outcome. Syncretism happens when two different belief systems and values get mixed together. So when syncretism enters our churches, it's a mix of some biblical values along with values from our society and culture that are clearly not biblical. I think the health and wealth gospel that began in the United States and is now spread all over the world, especially among the poor, is an example of syncretism right under our nose. We combine selected biblical values with American pragmatism, rugged individualism, and gross materialism. So we simply say, name it and claim it. We're a child of the king and we should live like one. Name it and claim it. We can get what we want. The health and gospel, the health and wealth gospel misses completely any sense that followers of Jesus must die to themselves. They must take up their cross, and they must and will suffer. Scott Moreau, in his book on contextualization in world missions, says, contextualizers should realize that one way to help avoid syncretism is to ensure that faith in Christ provides real answers to the problems people face, not simple theological formulations that have no feet in daily life. They can do this only by developing a deep understanding of the social and cultural context, ensuring that they know what they are dealing with rather than simply condemning it outright. This is why I became an anthropologist. I saw way too much missionary work that was just ignorant of the deep cultural and social structures of their society. They were so busy doing their mission work that they didn't either have the skills or take the time to really understand African people at the deep level. I believe Moreau is affirming that the best hedge against syncretism is, in fact, contextualization and intentional discipleship with people in their specific culture, cultural and religious context. Now, I'm getting near the end. Are we okay? Okay. No one's fallen asleep yet. Now, when you do, I'm going to stop. I got maybe about 10 more minutes. Now, in these lectures, yesterday and today, I've tried to show why contextualization is so important and why it is a biblical mandate and how the incarnation is more than just a theological doctrine, but it, in fact, is a model, a biblical model for contextualization. Now, if this is so obvious, as it seems to me, then why is there so much resistance to it? Why is there so much resistance to contextualization? Let me suggest a number of reasons and some of the obstacles and barriers that prevent us from contextualizing the gospel. Now, I also want you to hear me saying that we don't contextualize the gospel for someone else. Sometimes we get that idea, oh, I need to go contextualize the gospel for Papua New Guineans. No, we need to give them the permission through the power of the Holy Spirit to contextualize the gospel for themselves within their context. I've got 6 points. Number one, we place theology above culture. Whoa, did he just say that? We place theology above culture. Now, before you think I'm a heretic, listen carefully. We tend to think that our abstract, rational, cognitive theology, which was pounded out on the crucible of Western culture, is static and unchanging. We equate theology with scripture. We give to theology the same status as we give to scripture. The Bible's infallible. Our theology is not. The process of theologizing is reflecting on God and the Bible as they relate to us in a very specific culture at a particular time. But we have absolutized our theological products and not encouraged the process of theological reflection by the priesthood of all believers, not just the systematic theologians with PhDs. We fail to remember that it is in the context of a specific culture that theological reflection on the kingdom of God takes place. We need to encourage what Paul Hebert called many years ago self-theologizing in every social, cultural, and economic context. That's the first barrier. Number two, we have a very negative view of culture. We forget that the diversity of cultures of the world are simply gifts of God's grace, not the enemy of the gospel. We too often judge and evaluate cultural differences from the perspective of our own culture and conclude that they are wrong and evil. Our own ethnocentrism gets in the way, and it causes us to see cultural differences as wrong instead of just different. Number three. We confuse the meaning of the gospel with the cultural forms we use to communicate it. The meaning of the gospel and the cultural forms we use to communicate that. Now, the meaning of the gospel does not change. It's universal. It's everlasting. But the forms we use to communicate that meaning must change from culture to culture and from one era to another, from one generation to another, in order for the true meaning of the gospel to be communicated effectively. This is why we say God has no grandchildren. Each generation has got to hear the gospel as it relates to them. Worship music is a good example. From the hymn tunes of Charles Wesley's 18th century England, many of which were borrowed from the English pubs, to Ira Sankey's 19th century American gospel melodies, to contemporary Australian Hillsong praise courses. These different music forms have been used to express the same meaning of worshiping and giving glory to God. The forms will change, the meaning will not. I oftentimes say, there are no sacred forms. There are only sacred meanings. And we will die for our sacred forms. We have fights about what color the carpet should be in church. Goodness sakes, Lord have mercy. So we resist contextualization, believing that followers of Jesus in other cultures must use the same forms we do in order to be Christian. Does holiness look the same way all around the world? At the heart level, it should. At the form level, it better look quite differently. We forget that there are no sacred forms. There are only sacred meanings of the gospel. Number four. We do not want to give up power, position, privilege, and prestige. Now I've gone to meddling. Many of us have risen to positions of power, privilege, and prestige in our own churches. This is all the more the case where our mission work has been more about denominational extension than furthering the kingdom of God. We're afraid that if the church becomes too indigenous and too contextualized, it won't look like our churches back home, and we may lose our positions of authority. Remember what I noted yesterday, William Smalley's 1958 article on the indigenous church. He says, one mark of the indigenous church is the missionaries won't like it. They won't like it. Number five. We're afraid of losing control if the gospel is contextualized in a culture different from our own. Now, this barrier is similar to the previous one. We're afraid that if we don't maintain control of how the gospel is preached and lived out, and if we don't insist on the new followers of Jesus adopting our theological distinctives, then the church will become heretical, and believers will fall into heresy. Where is our confidence in the Holy Spirit to guide new believers in the same way we believe the Holy Spirit guides us? We have a lot of confidence that the Holy Spirit guides us, but do we really trust the Holy Spirit to guide others? Number six. A lack of missiological training and understanding fuels our fears of contextualization. A lack of missiological training and understanding fuels our fears of contextualization. The Bible gives us the content of our message, critical. This is why Bible studies are so important. Every seminary student should have as many biblical study courses as they possibly can. But missiology helps us understand the context in which the biblical message is communicated and lived out. Content and context. What is the gospel? For whom is the gospel good news? If we don't know the content of the gospel, then all kinds of beliefs, attitudes, and activities will fill the vacuum. But if we don't understand the context, then the gospel will not be proclaimed and lived out in ways that touch people at the deepest levels of their need. Unfortunately, very few missionaries are trained to think missiologically, and even fewer pastors understand its importance in their ministry. I wish every seminary across the world would have appropriate missiological training in their context. It hardly ever happens. Bible schools and seminaries around the world teach biblical studies and theology, but seldom missiology, which is crucial to connect the Bible and theology where people actually live day to day. So to our new president, Bruce, I want to encourage you to make missiology just as important on this campus as is biblical studies and theology. It's the missing piece. I finally come to the conclusion. Are you okay? Oh my goodness, did you see what time it is? I'll bet you're getting hungry, aren't you? Okay, well just be with me just a few more minutes. My prayer and hope for the Nazarene Asia Pacific region is that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we will overcome these obstacles and remove the resistance to contextualization. The gospel has always needed to engage culture in order to change lives and transform societies. A stereotypical generalization that carries some truth in it is this. The Jews originated Christianity. The Greeks spiritualized it. The Romans codified it. The Spaniards ritualized it. The Germans systematized it. The British taught it. And the Americans commercialized it and now sell it as a pre-packaged brand of religion. We take all over the world. Melba Maguy notes that, quote, wherever the gospel has been, Christianity both transforms and is transformed by the culture that receives it. How does the gospel relate to culture? Yesterday I mentioned the gospel affirms most of our culture, it critiques and condemns some of our culture, and it transforms all of our culture. Isn't it past time, long past time, for the gospel to become deeply contextualized in the cultures of Asia and the Pacific? For us to have greater confidence in the Holy Spirit to be at work in these cultures and superintend the contextualization process? Isn't it time for that? Isn't it time that theologies from this region emerge that empower people to engage the spiritual powers that too often hold them in fear? Isn't it time for us to become advocates instead of adversaries of contextualization? Yes, I believe it is. However, in order to enter into this missiological arena of radical biblical contextualization, all three words are important, radical, biblical, contextualization, we must be willing to relinquish our need for certainty. Relinquish our need for certainty in exchange for our quest for understanding. Relinquish our need for certainty in our quest in exchange for our quest for understanding. May God give us the wisdom and the courage to do so. Now I want to end with a benediction that comes from India. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father be with you. And may the Holy Spirit come upon you and disturb you and trouble you and set before you an impossible task and dare you to do it. Until in your desperation you fall on your knees and remain there until his power fills you, which alone will enable you to do it. And then, but only then, may the Lord grant you his peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.